eat fish.
Thank you.
He breathe air. Then he not breathe his mouth. Yeah, he was breathing with his body. See? He was trying to go to breathe. He was going to breathe. Now he was breathing. This is Kunimasu. This fish is from Lake Tazawa. It was very rare. It was always black, but sometimes here, there is a yellow white catfish. It was very big. You can see the tail. Two Biwa catfish.
Hey. Okay. キャフィーのポストカードいかがですか ?1 枚100円からです。
This is sweet fish. Small fish.
Yummy!
This is Biwamasu. We ate this fish for lunch today. Lake Biwa salmon. is from Lake Biwa.
This fish is from Lake Biwa. This is the latest species of Lake Biwa.
Thank you. さ、もうなくなってるから。
見えてない。
大きいのが今日来たら、また、あ、来た来た。
キャビア、ザ・エイザ・キャビア、イトワイ・ラト。ナッツ・ラト。
They feed the fish.
これでファーストイベア、僕は住んだらここだ。はい、おいで。はい、お手で出して。よし。ほらほら。
八郎技の誕生だ。溝を掘って湖と海をつなぐ。
丸こぶの。
No.
This is.
This is their bed.
I wonder.
Watch it.
So this is the longest continuous display of freshwater jellyfish in Japan. I've checked with other aquariums in Japan, and I'm quite sure that this is the longest. And I checked with some scientists in the US, and they also told me that they've never heard of so long continuous sculpture. So I think that this is the longest in the world too.
Welcome to the Lake Biwa Museum. I'm not your typical Japanese curator because I'm actually American, but I've been working here for 16 years. as the curator of miscellaneous invertebrates. That means not insects and not shells, all the other ones, the worms, the shrimps, and so forth. My own specialty is crustaceans, but not crabs and shrimp like most people think of. I started off with things that are like you might call parasitic barnacles. And in Lake Biwa area, I study the shrimps that live in rice paddies, but they are not real shrimps. These are tadpole shrimps, fairy shrimps, and clam shrimps. That's really my specialty, weird things that nobody ever heard of. By the time I went to graduate school, I knew one thing. I wanted to be a specialist in something that nobody else was working on, and that nobody else had worked on for a long time. That is how you can make great discoveries fast. Take something that's been totally ignored. And although I had studied invertebrates very extensively, you know, for junior high school onwards, when I entered graduate school, my as yet undetermined major professor, he became my major professor, said, well, why don't you take a stab at these being something called Ascothoracida, and these being something I had never heard of. If I had never heard of them, then obviously they were exactly the right thing for me. And I instantly began to make major discoveries related to them, not just as far as that group is concerned, but with relevance to crustacea as a whole. So I successfully completed my PhD, and then, as I said, I went off to various museums, marine laboratories around the world for a while, including fairly long stints in Okinawa and two universities in Japan, whereby I was in place when this museum, the Lake Biwa Museum, offered a curator position to anybody, not just Japanese as usual. And in Japan, particularly clam shrimps, there have been no serious work since the 1920s. So therefore, it's another situation where if you do almost anything, you will make something that's a discovery and that's publishable, and you'll make a name for yourself and your museum fairly quickly. If you pick crayfish to study, that won't happen. Crayfish are just too well known, too many people are studying them, and finding out something new and interesting is a bit difficult. And then I decided to bite the bullet and take charge of a big project, and the big project was basically biological survey of the unknown fauna of Lake Biwa and its surrounding bodies of water, including, say, rice paddies and caves, if there's pools in the caves, groundwater, and even Lake Biwa habitats that aren't checked very often, like the very deep lake bottom. In this exhibit case, we're showing almost all of the cell bugs that live in Shiga Prefecture, well, that we know about. But we probably know the great majority of them because we have thousands of samples, mostly taken by a previous staff member who was very interested in shrimps. Now, cell bugs don't look like shrimps, but they are crustaceans. Japan has something like 200 species of these things in all of its nooks and crannies, but most of those nooks and crannies are along the coast. Inland is not well surveyed for these things, and part of the reason is that people thought ahead of time that there shouldn't be much diversity of them inland. But including the few pieces of old literature that exist, which is only one or two, we now know that there is 22 species of cell bugs living in Shiga. And many of them are introduced species, and they're introduced, you know, throughout Japan and other parts of the world too. But of these 22 species, we have 20 of them here, seven of them, that's about a third of the total, were new, undescribed species. That was very surprising, to have such a high representation of unknown creatures for a group like this, which everybody knows and can recognize in their own backyard.
Since I was a small boy, I used to love nature. I like playing in forests and catching insects and frogs and fish. When I went to the university, I studied biology and ecology and kept it up. But initially I started studying monkeys, but gradually I studied more smaller organisms. And finally got my doctorate degree on working on ciliates, single-celled animals. So this is called Apocarchesium rosettum. It's a newly found species from Lake Biwa. And it is a species of ciliate. Ciliates are protozoans. It has this long stalk, which then this stalk contracts. So if you, for example, I'm gonna just give some stimulation and it will, here, it disappeared. But it's because the stalk contracted, so it's right now here. And gradually the stalk is elongating now. And its species name, rosettum, I named it because this looks like a rose. And now you see it contracted. Well, myself and then my colleague in China. So he was the first author of that paper, and I was the second author. And you can see it's spiral.
But see, this is an example of one of those relatively unsurveyed habitats I mentioned, namely surfaces of water plants or surfaces of items of debris. There's lots of organisms attached to that or wandering through the forest made by the attached ones.
And see here, this is another ciliate, it's called stentor. And if you wait a while, it will start elongating. And it's opening its mouth. Species of a hydrozoa. It's like a hydra. But this is called Pachycodermi. And it's a colonial species. There aren't many people who are doing research on them, so so far it's only reported from Lake Biwa, but that doesn't mean it lives only in Lake Biwa. It's eaten water flea. So you can see the eye of the water flea here.
And that's very likely to be an undescribed species, because there are very, very, there's not many. The larger flatworms from Lake Biwa are pretty well known, but the smaller ones are not.
Change them. Here. And here.
It's another relative of the first one, but it doesn't make colonies.
Yeah, this is also a paratrich trick. Of course, they have to have food. So, for example, there are some water weeds here. And so as the water weeds rot, then bacteria will decompose the leaves, and then the bacteria will be eaten by the protozoans, and the ostracods might eat the protozoa, something like that. So it's a whole ecosystem within this petri dish. So then these organisms will grow within this petri dish. Over here is an ostracod. Ostracod is a crustacean. And in our museum, we have a specialist on ostracods too. Oh, There are ones which look like this, but are rare.
Well, that's the thing. See, as part of his contribution to the project, he surveyed as best he could all of Lake Biwa for ostracods and found 40 species, 16 of which were new. Of ostracod that came from likely both of the wells. So in back there's a modern house which used to be in the what used to be the garden. It has a the old garden well is now indoors. But anyway, both wells had but there's ostracods and copepods in this water.
Plankton is an organism, animal or plant, which lives drifting or floating in the water. So jellyfish are plankton. So by definition, plankton are organisms which live floating or drifting in the water. So today we will all go to Lake Biwa outside and we will collect plankton and you will observe the plankton which you have collected yourself. And so you will collect the plankton using this net. This net is called a plankton net. And a rope is attached to the net, and it's about 10 meters long. And then if you throw the net 10 meters and pull it, you can concentrate a plankton about 10,000 times. First, coil the rope neatly because if you don't coil the rope neatly, it might get tangled. Now, I'll throw the net. And wait for a few seconds. And then gradually retrieve the net. You can see some tiny things swimming. They're jumping around.
There's one green one.
Mm.
Me too. I see it.
Actually, you can see.
Yeah. I see a baby.
And turn the valve and okay, like this. Okay. So everyone, please collect your own plankton. Yeah. The pool.
Thank you.
on my hand.
The teacher said there are a lot of plankton here.
This is my plankton.
This is my plankton.
I got 1 million plankton.
No.
No. You have a billion.
No.
Okay.
So
No.
Is it heavy?
Yes.
Okay, be careful.
Microscope in front of you is called a stereoscopic microscope. If you look using both of your eyes, you can see the plankton in three dimension, 3D. It's better to observe in low magnification and find something and then zoom up.
Wow, look at that screen.
Whoa. Okay, now pour a small amount of your plankton onto the dish.
Okay.
Like this. And before you pour, maybe better to just mix it a little like this.
Mix
and
it
then,
a little bit, but don't shake. Pour a little bit. That's enough. Stop.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, look at this. It's a big one. I see.
Okay. So, okay. Just let me see it all. I just look. Microscope.
Okay, I can't see it.
Okay. Okay. Now look at it. You can see dots now.
I have a lot of plankton in here.
Wow. The plankton is dancing.
Oh, there's so many plankton.
I found mother. Look at my plankton. Yeah, look.
The mud makes a very nice pattern.
Yeah, it's beautiful, but it makes it more difficult to observe the plankton. Yes, now we can look, see it clearly.
Thank you.
We って言わなくてもいいんだよ。There are names of the plankton here, and the names are very, very difficult because these are scientific names. For most of the plankton, you do not have English names. Some, for example, like water flea, there are English names, but for most of the plankton, it's scientific names. So it's very, very difficult names, and it says page 40. So then you go to page 40, and on page 40, you can see many green algae. It's called, they're called chlorophytes.
Oh, where is it? Yes, I see. Yes, well done. That's right.
Okay, so then you get this.
I saw one.
No, which one? Left door?
I found box.
No, you go get him.
Okay, there's the door. Yep, there's the door. Yeah, you've got microscopes. Okay.
Really?
Yep. Oh. There isn't Brachyrhinus, but this one is here. Cinquita. This one.
Bingo!
Bingo!
Mm.
I found Dunkley.
This one is called Eodiaptomus. In Japanese, it's called Higenaga Kenmijinko. You can see that it has the long hige. So that's why it's called Higenaga Kenmijinko. So this is the Leptodora. This is Leptodora, it's carnivorous. It eats other zooplankton. And you can see it has one large eye in the middle of its head here. So it has big eyes so it can see very well. This is Daphnia. The Daphnia is this one here. And you can see it has babies on its back. And here, you can see a plankton like a spring. This is called Anabina. This one here, this one also has one eye here. And it has, on its back, it has its babies. And these dark dots are the eyes of the babies. Volvox. And this is the mother colony. And within the mother colony are its daughter colonies. And within the daughter colonies are its granddaughter colonies. So they have grandchildren even before their daughters are born. And all these fish, when they're small, they eat plankton. So if there aren't any plankton, there wouldn't be any fish. And if there are no fish, there wouldn't be any birds which eat the fish. So the plankton, and it doesn't have to be plankton, but some might be attached or living in the bottom. But these small organisms, like plankton, are the base of the whole water ecosystem.
Thank you for the great experience. We had a fun time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
まず船寿司なんですけれども、ご存知の通り滋賀県を代表する郷土料理であり、発酵食品です。そして、慣れ寿司の一種です。慣れ寿司というのは、ご飯と魚を漬けたものの総称です。 ですので、この慣れ寿司の中にこの船寿司も入りますし、あと、うぐいとお米をつけたもの、うぐい寿司とかいうのもありますし、ハスという魚で作れば、ハス寿司。モロコというもので作れば、モロコ寿司というふうに言われます。で、ご飯と魚で作った発酵食品の総称を慣れ寿司と。で、この慣れ寿司というのは、現在の握り寿司ありますね。あれの起源なんです。 昔はお寿司というのは魚とご飯を発酵させてたものがお寿司だったんですね。それが時代をどんどん来るに従って、昔はこういう発酵させて1年間ぐらい時間がかかってたんですけれども、まあそんな待ってられないということで、早慣れという付け方があります。でそれはご飯と漬けて2週間から1ヶ月ぐらいでも食べてしまう。漬け込み時間が短い。 そういうお寿司も開発されました。で、最近っていうか、その現代のお寿司はもう発酵期間をなくしてしまって、その代わり、酢を入れて酸っぱみをつけて、お寿司にした、魚と一緒に、ご飯と食べる。それが現代のお寿司です。まさにこのように、カマンベールチーズのような、濃厚な、味わいだという。 ことで、実際に外国の方とかに食べていただくと、あのチーズみたいだっていう、あの感想がよく書いてあります。あとは神事によく登場します。で県内の、いろんな神社ありますけど、そのいくつかの神社ではこの船寿司を、まあ、神様のお供え物として使っています。で特に有名、県内で有名なのはこの下新川神社の寿司切り祭りというのがあって、このようにこの若者がですね、船寿司を切るっていう、を切ってあのお供えするんですけど、切るっていう、まあ、こういう行事があって、これは非常に有名な、イベントですね。このように神事にも登場するということで、船寿司というのは、まあ、最初に発酵食品と言いましたけれども、ただの発酵食品ではないと思われます。このようにいろんな天皇さんへ献上されてたり、まあ、神事に使われてたということもありますので、まあ、発酵食品で、まあ、庶民の人ももちろん食べてたと思うんですけれども、おそらく当時の人にとっては特別なもので、でニゴロブナの仔魚、生まれたばかりの赤ちゃんですね、これを田んぼに放流して、まあ、これぐらいの全長5ミリぐらいの小さなものを放流して、その後、1ヶ月間ぐらい田んぼの中で飼育します。で1ヶ月飼育す、田植えから1ヶ月経つと、この農家さん、この水を抜く作業っていうのをやるんですね。中干しという作業を農家さんはやります。これは稲の成長を良くするために、一旦田植えから1ヶ月したら水を抜くっていう作業をします。でもちろん水を抜かれると、まあ、魚は干上がってしまうので、その水を抜かれるタイミングで一緒に、水と一緒にもうこの水路に出してしまって、もうそのまま琵琶湖までこう流してやる、そのような方法で1ヶ月間だけ田んぼで飼育するというふうなやり方をする。で、成長したニゴロブナはこんな感じですね。だいたい2センチから3センチぐらい成長したものがここから流れていって、それで琵琶湖まで放流されて、まあ、琵琶湖でこう大きくなるということです。で外的に、外来魚、特に外来魚ですね、外来魚に襲われないという利点、あと水温が高い、あと、ミジンコなどの餌が豊富という理由で、このようなことを力を入れて、
洗うときはこういう真鍮製のブラシを使っています。亀のこだわしでも全然いいんですけれども、この方が早くきれいになります。で、まずこの船ですね、塩を洗い流して、この表面をきれいにするために、まあ、ちょっと水でも流しながら、こういう感じで磨いていきます。でこの時にこすりすぎるとこの皮が破けてしまうので、力加減はある程度気にしながらやってください。で、キッチンペーパーでこう表面を軽くこう拭ってやって、で、まあ、このエラの中もまあちょこっと拭いてやって、これで大丈夫ですね。で DVD 動画ではこれを洗濯バサミにこう吊るして、こうやって2時間ぐらい干せって書いてあります。これも別にやってもやらなくてもいいんですけど、まあ、で手くっつくんでちょっと濡らしてもらって、このエラの中にご飯をこのように詰めていきます。で、最初に見ていただいてた動画の中では、お腹の中にも詰めろっていうふうに言ってたんですけれども、お腹の中にはもう詰めなくても大丈夫です。でもうエラ蓋が開くほどいっぱい入れてもらって、あとこの口の中にも入れてください。しっかりしっかり。でこれがしっかり入れてないと、この肝心の頭の部分の発酵がよく発酵がしません。そうするとこの一番硬い骨ですね、この頭の硬い骨が発酵せずに硬いまんまになってしまいますんで、このお腹じゃないわ、このエラ蓋の中とこのお口の中に入れるのはしっかり入れてください。でもう溢れるぐらい、ちょっと開き気味ぐらいでいいです。こんな状態ですね。でお口の中にももう入れてください。ちょっとなんかかわいそうな絵になってますけど、こんな感じで。で、まず、まあ、最初はどっち向きでもいいんですけど、こういうふうにとにかく魚が重ならないことと、あと魚とビニールがくっついてしまわないようにある程度隙間を空けるんですけれども、あまりこう好き好きにやりすぎるとこの段数だけかさばっていて、お米がたくさん必要なので、その辺も考えながらきれいにこういう風に並べていきます。 いい感じになったんで、まあ、こういう感じで、
はい、
あの魚を並べます。でこの時に魚と魚同士がくっつかないように、まあ、ちょっとヒレぐらい重なるのはいいんですけど、この魚の本当に体と体が重なるとそこの部分が発光しないので、はい、こんな感じで。これそしたらね、袋のシワを伸ばして、今つけてもらうときは本当にもう置いてもらっただけなので、この一番最後に、グッと押していきます。こういう感じですか、この、手のひらのところでグッと押して、こういう袋、このビニールをこう伸ばしながらこういう感じで、これをここに最後上に乗せて、これはあのバランスを取る役目があるので、若干その気休め程度みたいにくらいにしかなってないんですけど、で内蓋を乗せて、でこれで完成ですね。であとは重しを乗せて、重しを乗せた後に最後ビニール袋をバサッと上からかぶせたら、あのゴミとか虫が入らないんで、それでここでキュッと結んでもらって、でこれであとは、お正月までもう一切手をさ、まあ、手が触らない、でお正月になったらもう美味しい話ができる。
This is delicious!
We love Lake Biwa Museum!
We love Lake Biwa Museum!
We love Lake Biwa Museum!
There are many lotus flowers here.
I can go up. It's a million thousand.
The lotus flowers are very beautiful.
We love Mizunomori.
That case is other name. This was royal knight's case. Knight, not knife. Knight. This one looks like a knife. Like that knife is.